thank you very much for having me, and thank you, Matt and Jane, for the introductions. I'm here in the spirit of optimism. I actually come from this industry. I spent the last 10 years working as a researcher, an innovation brand growth consultant, and I left, as Matt said, about 6 months ago, 8 months ago now, from Wolf Olins to pursue this issue, this climate crisis, climate and ecological crisis, see what I can do about it, see what I can do to help. I am an optimist. At Wolf Olins, we had the expression, ambitious for our clients and optimistic for the world, and that still lives with me. And that optimism is kind of a choice. It's a choice between two kinds of change. We have climate change on one hand and system change on the other. And the choice here is one that requires courage. But I think when we realize quite how perilous this choice over here is in climate change and how much promise there is in the system change, certainly when we realize that we understand this thing and we know what to do about it and we can do this, then it becomes an easy choice to make, pursuing the system change. But that begins with facing that change and doing so with intention and courage, as I say, and recognizing that some things are already beyond the pale here. We've already gone past certain things. There are lives that have been destroyed by what we're going to talk about here that cannot be retrieved. But we can't go forward without facing what comes next, without having the courage to make the change, to choose system change, and to go forward in the right direction. And at the moment, we're not quite making that choice. At the moment, we are in denial about this. And this is essentially what Extinction Rebellion is here to do, is to draw attention to that denial and try and help us overcome it. It's a very understandable thing, that denial. It's a very natural response to situations like this that we have essentially evolved not to cope with very well. And so it's very understandable. And it's also a sort of defensive position, denial. It's not the result of a lack of information or understanding. It's us defending against having to do things that we find uncomfortable. But at the moment, this is pretty much where we are. This is a real photo from Oregon when the fires are in California. And this is kind of us at the moment. We're playing golf while the house is on fire. An Extinction Rebellion, you could think of as a fire alarm. And fire alarms are quite annoying, aren't they, when they go off? You have to go outside, maybe put a scarf on, leave your work, quite irritating, until you realize that there is a fire. And then you're quite grateful for the alarm. And what comes next is the fire brigade. And we are all part of that fire brigade now. So it's now up to us, really, all of us, to put down our golf clubs, to pick up our fire extinguishers, and to pick up the tools that will help us design and rebuild the house so that it doesn't catch fire again. So that's what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to begin here. Just want to ask you to take a moment. You don't need to close your eyes or anything like that. To just imagine your ideal world. What does that look like? What does that feel like as a place? What matters to you in that world? What is your family doing? Do you have a family? What are your friends doing? Who are they? Where are you living? What's your career? What's your job? Just hold that in your mind as we go through the next little bit here. So we are going to talk about the peril, and we're going to talk about the promise. And the peril is essentially what the science is telling us. And I want to be very clear that the science I'm going to talk through is conservative. It is the mainstream opinion. It is not extreme. It is not edge case. It is not niche. We're going to be looking at mainstream conservative science here. And it begins with this point as well. This is not about saving the planet. The climate and ecological crisis is not a case of us running around saying, save the planet. And there's a good reason for that, which is that we don't really care about it. It's hard for us to care about it. I can't say that I care about saving the planet. I care about saving myself, and I care about saving the people that I love. But getting my head around saving that is basically impossible. But that's okay, because we are talking about saving ourselves here. Because this thing is our only life support system. We've only got one of them. There is no planet B. The nearest habitable planet outside Mars, which is a desert and very hard to live on, is several light years away, and you would weigh 75 tons on the surface. So this is all we've got. This is our life support system. It gives us the food, water, and air that we need to survive. And at the moment, we're destroying those things. We're destroying the climate. We're destroying its ecology, our planet's ecology, and therefore we're destroying our future. So we know how we're doing this. And I'm hoping lots of you will sort of understand this already, so I'm going to go through it relatively quickly, and hopefully, if anything, you just pull out of this some useful ways to think and talk about this. But we know what's happening here. We're putting a lot of emissions into our atmosphere, and that's causing the planet to heat up. And that's essentially incontrovertible at this point. There are people who say that's not what's happening, but they don't have enough evidence to suggest their argument is true. So we're going with, this is what is happening. And it's happening really fast. This is the temperature change from 1850 to more or less today. And you can see how quickly that spike in temperature, the dangerous temperature that we're talking about here, is happening. And this, by the way, is the front page of The Economist. So again, this is very mainstream. And it's also happened very, very recently. This is something we tend to not sort of conceive of when we're thinking about this crisis. It's something that's happening far away, something that's happening not to us. 85% of the emissions in the atmosphere have been released since the end of World War II, the emissions that are doing the damage. And 50% since the first episode of The Simpsons was aired in 1989. So this has happened recently. It's happened within a generation, really. Which should give us a sense of hope, because we can probably undo it as quickly if we really put our minds to it. We know now what we're aiming for here, and that is, according to the IPCC, the consensus view on what's happening here from scientists, we need to try and stay at 1.5 degrees warming, heating, above pre-industrial levels. The problem with these numbers is that they're small, but the impact is massive, and we don't often understand that. So, to describe that and explain that, between 2 degrees and 1.5 degrees, which used to be the target, right, 2 degrees, if we went from 1.5 degrees to 2 degrees, 150 million people would likely die from pollution alone. That is double the number of people that died in World War II. That is three times the number of people that died during the Great Leap Forward, and it's something like 11 Holocausts. And that's pollution alone. It would also cost us $20 trillion. And it would also be damaging, three times more damaging, to the planet in general and our lives on it than 1.5 degrees. The other aspect here is that these numbers are global averages. So when we talk about 1.5 degrees, that even that number can mean as much as sort of 5 to 8 degrees warmer over land. It's already 20 degrees warmer in the Arctic right now, and we're at 1.1 degrees. That's where we are right now, 1.1 degrees, 20 degrees warmer in the Arctic. So if you imagine that it was 39 degrees in London for a day last summer, right, and it kind of ground to a halt, the train stopped working, and there were fights at Lido's, right? That was one day. Imagine 5 days in a row at 45 degrees, several times in a summer. You start to see how that is hard to deal with, right? That's why we need to stay at 1.5. And right now, we're currently heading for 4 degrees. If we did everything that the Paris Climate Agreement suggested, we would have hit 3.7 degrees. So even if we did all of those things, we wouldn't reach it. We need to massively uptick what we are doing here. And that's what we're going to look at, because it's possible. But right now, that is where we're heading. And we'll see in a minute that that is not a good place to be. The other thing to notice here is that the temperatures we're heading into are temperatures we've not seen on this planet for a very long time. In fact, we have not seen them. We have never seen these temperatures. This is us, basically. This is us having our civilization here, this nice little comfort zone, quite flat. And we're coming out of it into these spikes up here. And the last time it was 4 degrees warmer, there were alligators in the Arctic. So one of the big risks here is that we simply don't know if we can survive that. We don't know if we can live in those conditions. The other aspect of this then, carbon in the atmosphere, is the destruction of the ecology. And this is actually often missing from the conversation, because climate crisis is easy to say, but climate's an ecological crisis is a bit harder. But what we're doing right now is destroying our ecology in a way that is quite extraordinary. And that is largely down to what we are consuming. We need 5 planet Earths right now in order to all live like Americans. And we don't have 5 planet Earths, as we said earlier. So we need to do something quite different there. And because of that, we're accelerating the extinction of the biodiversity on our planet. We are in the 6th mass extinction, arguably. And during these events, historically, between 80, 90% of life on Earth goes. And that's a problem for us. We've already seen 60% of animals lost in the last 40 years or so. It's a problem for us because that biodiversity is not about cutesy animals and oh dear, poor koalas. Again, because we sort of can care about them, but we don't really care about them because we care about us more. Which is okay again, because this is about us. Without that biodiversity, without that wildlife, we cannot survive. We need it for our sake. And if we don't have it, we will not make it. So understanding that point is really important. And recognizing that what we're doing to our ecology is therefore undermining our ability to live is really vital. We are essentially sawing off the branch that we are sitting on. It's a very sort of clear way of thinking about this. So what does that mean doing? It means us changing our mindset. We have a long-standing belief that ecology is our commodity that we can take advantage of, a resources, set of resources, that we are somehow superior to and separate from nature. Something that reveals the absurdity of that thought quite quickly is if you count all the cells in the human body, only 43% of them are human cells. The rest are other organisms in our gut, on our hair, skin, and so on. So not only are we're not separate from nature, we very much are nature. We are interdependent with it. We depend on it, it depends on us. We cannot exist without it. So it's much better for us to think about ecology as our community. Resources, no. Relatives, yes. As silly as that sounds. Because without this, we can't exist, and we need to think about it in that way. What have we been doing about this? Not enough, basically. So Antonio Guterres, UN Secretary General, says that it's been 30 years of utterly inadequate efforts. Best intentions, maybe, but not doing enough. And that is the amount of carbon in the atmosphere, and you can see it going up in a hockey stick sort of direction, certainly exponentially, and that's all the big things we've done about it. The hope is that this now is flattening off, and coronavirus might be playing a role in that, but last year, emissions apparently flattened. But we need to bring them down much faster than that. We have to halve them by 2050, 2030 maybe even. That's reducing them by 7.6% year on year, which we're not doing yet. One of the reasons for this is that our whole economy, our system, is built on fossil fuels. And a way of thinking about that is that it's a bit like a credit card. If you remember being a student at university and you go to the uni bar and you've got a credit card, you're like, brilliant, I can buy champagne, it's going to be awesome, we're going to have a fun night. And you sort of forget that what seems like free money actually comes with quite a big bill later and some interest. And we've been doing that with fossil fuels. By not attributing the true cost to these fuels, i.e. the impact on our ecology and the impact on our climate, we have been building this bill for ourselves, which we now have to pay. And we can't pay it off with a credit card because essentially our credit rating is not good anymore. And one way to look at that as well is to recognize the carbon bubble problem. This number down here is our budget for the amount of carbon we can put in the atmosphere based on staying at 1.5 degrees. And that is how much we have currently accounted for underground to the tune of something like $50 trillion that we are planning to dig up and use. So we can't do that for obvious reasons. If we want to stay under 1.5 and continue to exist, we cannot go after that. And that's a very difficult thing to do because our entire economy depends on it. It requires some quite significant system change and belief change to get us out of being dependent in that way. And the people who run all of this are starting to work that out, which is really encouraging. So Larry Fink of BlackRock said this recently in his letter to CEOs, which people tend to pay attention to. It's the defining factor in companies' long-term prospects, climate change. There will be a significant reallocation of capital, and that is already happening, divestment, et cetera. It's already happening, and it's happening quickly. One of the things that is challenging in this, and the reasons that we're continuing in this direction, is that we don't really measure the right thing. We talk about carbon emissions in this country and bringing them down, and aren't we good? I watched a Panorama report about this, where they actually sort of celebrated the fact that one of the ways we've done that is by sending our production to China. Which is insane, isn't it? Because we're all in this together. So we need to measure our carbon consumption instead, and that's a little bit harder. That's one of the challenges. It is hard to do that. But if we're not measuring all of the emissions that we are responsible for in all of the things that we're using, then we're giving the wrong picture. And it means we end up making the wrong kind of accusations as well. So we tend to say, oh, but it's China and India, and if they don't do it, why should we do it if they're not going to do it? They're the ones causing the problem. If you look historically at the amount of carbon in the atmosphere, you look at who's responsible for the most, the USA is pretty far out in front. So for them to say, no, China, it's up to you, we're not doing it unless you do something, is a bit mad. It's a bit like inviting them to a 12-course dinner, but only for dessert, and then asking them to split the bill. They're not going to do that. Look where India is as well, right? They're another one that appears here. So I think being sort of open and understanding about this and recognizing that it's all of us or none of us in this situation, it is a zero-sum game, but at that level, and coronavirus, I would suggest, is sort of revealing this point to us a little bit at the moment. We have to recognize this, and we have to drive our collective cooperative actions based on this understanding. So what's encouraging is that there are people out in the streets now talking about this. When I was getting back into this, getting interested in it in 2017, the climate and climate crisis had been mentioned in the newspapers, mainstream media, less often than picnics. And now we're in a very different place. And Extinction Rebellion has a lot to be thanked for in that regard. Again, ringing that alarm. But waking up is hard to do. Not everyone is there. And I'm sure there are behavioral scientists in the room who recognize a lot of this stuff. It's hard to get through this stuff. We've been hardwired to not respond to things like this, to think in short-term ways. And overcoming that is difficult. It takes the people who can think long-term, who are essentially therefore privileged, to do their very best to pave the way for the people who are more short-term in their thinking. Not to sort of point the finger at them and say, well, you're bad, you're thinking short-term, but to try and help them, care them across the line. And a big thing that we all need to recognize here, and this is very important for this industry, is that climate change, climate crisis, climate emergency, whatever we want to call it, is not a story. It has been for a long time, a story, an issue. It is no longer that. It is the setting within which all stories take place. There is no escaping this. And if we are not talking about this all the time, in everything we are doing, and considering this setting, when we are telling clients what we want them to do, then we are sending them in a very, very dangerous direction. If I was still working in innovation and presenting a range of scenarios to my clients and saying, do this, this, and this, here's an opportunity, and not grounding that in the setting here, I would be sending them into failure. So it's really important that we grasp this. So what does all of this mean? All of this science, all of these things. Who has children in the room? Lots of people. Anyone just had a child? Okay, so I'm going to ask you to imagine that you have just had a child. And we're going to look at the lifetime of that child, looking at some of the impacts from what we're talking about. Again, remembering this is quite conservative, and the scenario I'm going to paint here is pretty much where we're heading and not a worst-case scenario. But we're going to make some assumptions. So we're starting here, it's 2020, we're 1.1 degrees. We're going to assume that we don't do enough at this point. And there are indications that we are going to try and do more, as we'll get into in a second. But we're going to assume that we don't do enough, right, at this point. That everybody leaves this room today and just carries on with what they were doing before, as they were. Jumping to 2050, 2 degrees. We've hit 2 degrees. All those people have died, right, we mentioned earlier, 150 million. All of that cost incurred. This is what's going on. Those heat waves are happening 5 times as long and probably 32 times more often. Many homes have become uninsurable. Some people argue that 2 degrees is an uninsurable number. 4 degrees certainly is. The whole industry just falls at this point. 5 billion people most likely without resources on the planet. Water scarcity is already a massive problem. And this is the big number down here. The number of people who will be displaced by what is happening here. The majority of them women. And it's quite hard to get our heads around these numbers, again. Like, we're not equipped to think about millions and billions and trillions very easily. So I'm going to give you a very useful frame for it. I'm sure some of you have heard it before. If we count the seconds, it's easier, right? So A million is 11 days worth of seconds, right? A billion is 30 years worth of seconds. That's quite a big jump. And then a trillion is 30 millennia. So that's how big those things are. And we're talking about possibly 30 years worth of people needing a new home. That's the population of North and South America wandering around the world right now. And remember that the Syrian crisis was caused by 1 million people. So the difference between 11 days worth of people and 30 years worth of people by 2050, if we don't do enough. I'm going to jump again to this point, 2100. It's 4 degrees at this point, and this is what's going on. The damage caused by this costs double global wealth. We literally cannot afford it in any sense. Most of life on Earth is being lost. As I said, that mass extinction well underway. Uninhabitable countries, it's already 50 degrees outside in Dubai. When it's 60, 65, it's not possible to live there. Resources for 1 billion people, according to many estimates. So we're up in those with the alligators in the Arctic, trying to eke out an existence on very limited resources. Global peace is obviously quite difficult at this point. And really, society, that we understand it, as we understand it, has collapsed. We won't be sitting in conference rooms like this, going back to our offices and continuing their work. We'll be in a very different world. And that's quite soon, that's 2100, and we don't want that, do we? But I'm like, I'm not going to be around there. Do Do I care? It's hard, isn't it, right? I don't have children. Even if I did, would I care? Yeah, I'd try to. It feels far away, and that's still a problem. So let's recognize that it's also happening now. That scenario, 4 degrees, is far away in time, relatively, 2100, not in the grand scheme of things. And what we're talking about here is the future of life on this planet, and us particularly, but it's happening already. Whether it's in Australia, where yes, there were fires, but there were also floods last February that killed 150 million cattle, or in California, where the true natural disaster story, which they tend to be about too much nature, as George Monbiot said, the real nature horror story is no nature. And that's what The Road talks about, or in Mozambique, more flooding. So it's happening now. But again, it's like, yeah, but it's not here, right? I don't recognize those places, really. Australia's a bit like here, but it's all the way over there. Except that it is happening here, and it is happening here now. Pollution already kills more people than smoking in this country. Something like 12,000 people are dying every day around the world because of pollution. And in the UK, it will cost us £20 billion a year to deal with those deaths, and it already does, really. And we've already seen what's been happening with flooding, and it's happening more and more, very, very quickly. A town in Wales, Fairbourne, was decommissioned because it was too close to the sea and the levels are rising. Crop yields are down 60%, something like that already. This is, we're in this, right? This is now, here, now. So now what? First, I want you to just think about how that feels. How that feels in relation to that scenario you were imagining about your ideal world at the beginning. What does that look like now with that in mind? This is the greatest challenge we have ever faced as a species. There is no question about that. But the reality is, we know exactly what to do about it. We have all the solutions already, and we can go after them. Just need to choose to, just need to have the courage. So let's look at what that means. The first thing to note is that we tend to sort of misinterpret Darwin a little bit. We think that it's about the survival of the fittest, the sort of single, individualistic, competitive spirit running around. That's not actually what he said. What he talked about was those who can best manage change being those who can survive. And those people in our history were the ones who cooperated and who had resilience and who continue to be optimistic. So that's what we need right now. And we can have that, and many people already do. But the thing underneath all of this that's really sort of sitting behind all of these issues is our economy. And we basically need to think about that quite differently. So the way our economy and political systems work must change, or they will perish, brackets, and so will we eventually. We need a dynamic capitalist economy that gives everybody a justified belief that they can share in the benefits. So this isn't about pulling down capitalism. Extinction Rebellion is often sort of accused of wanting to just tear it all down. And some people do, and I'm not going to dispute that. But the reality is that we just need to do it differently, do it better. And again, we know how to do that. This, by the way, is not a quote from some kind of lefty rag. This is the chief economist of the FT, Martin Wolf. The FT is talking about this, rewiring the economy, and it's what we need to do. And we have the answers for that, a lot of them. This is a great example. Kate Raworth's Donut Economics. How do we end the deprivation in society whilst ending the degradation of our natural world? A lot of people already using this model, a lot of people already thinking about it. How do we shape our organizations around this principle and recognize that economics is not about laws and machines, and it's not really a science. It was developed as a science out of essentially envy for the scientists at the time. It's about people. It's about weird, peculiar behaviors, and therefore it's actually a question of design, one that we can all play a role in. And part of that design is recognizing that inequality is a design failure. Simon Kuznets, who suggested that we need to have inequality rise as development goes and then it will come down again the other side, he himself, having drawn that on the back of a napkin, said that that wasn't right. It wasn't distributive enough. It was too narrow-minded. And he's right. The problem with inequality, and by the way, a really good way of imagining this, is to count everybody's wealth in the world in $100 bills and pile it up. And if you do that in a single pile, most people in the world are sat on the floor. We here in this room probably sat at the height of a chair, maybe a bit higher. And the billionaires at the top, they are in outer space. That is how big a gap that is. And the problem with that, it's not an ideological problem of distributing wealth, etc. The problem is that it's pragmatic. It's a pragmatic problem. We can't make decisions well if that's the separation of people. So we need to recognize that and close that gap, very importantly, so that we can choose the right things now and go in the right direction. One of the problems in this economic thinking, where we think about it, is we completely ignore the value and the role, really, of the household and the commons. And by commons, I essentially mean our ecology. These dots here, right? That on the right is the value of low and unpaid work done by women in the world, if you were to try and put a figure on it, $10.8 trillion. That is just shy of the Chinese economy, which is the second biggest economy in the world. And that dot on the left is the size of the global tech industry. So it's three times the size of it, right? And currently, we just ignore that value. If you were to pay the average housewife or husband for the sort of going rate of all the tasks they do in a day, driving around, cooking, etc., they would be earning 120 grand a year, roughly. We're just ignoring that value. So we need to recognize it and take us on a journey. A journey towards thinking like this about our economy, designing it differently, to instead of being divisive and degenerative, which is currently what we're doing with it, something that is distributive and regenerative. And that distributive point is really worth thinking about in the context of energy. And back to that fossil fuels point, that credit card doesn't work anymore, right? So what have we got instead? If you harnessed all of the energy from the sun for an hour, all of it, it would power the planet permanently for a year. The whole year, 1 hour. At the moment, our solar panels, and there are obviously resource challenges with building these things, but our solar panels, even functioning at 20% capacity, could, with that many on the planet, power the Earth permanently. That's sort of roughly the size of Spain, which maybe seems like a lot, but you distribute that around the planet in the right places and start thinking of energy as infrastructure rather than an industry, and we're starting to go in the right direction. There are currently 800 million people without electricity in the world who are in poverty, therefore. This would take them out of poverty, doing this, providing distributed energy networks, new technologies which exist to help those people. And recognizing this point in this, the brilliant Cristiano Figueres, real hero in all of this, most, if not all, measures to address climate change actually bring a better quality of life. This is about making things better for people, quickly. In the US, 45,000 jobs are up for grabs from coal. That sounds like a lot, except that 300,000 to 400,000 jobs are up for grabs through renewable energy. There's no real debate in that. And we know how to do it. So Cambridge Institute for Sustainability Leadership is a fantastic place to go and learn. I really recommend it. And they have this, rewiring the economy, 10 years, 10 tasks. Very clear, very clean. Project Drawdown is a fantastic resource. It lists out all of the solutions that we know how to do. They recently released a report that suggested that we can do existing things we already know how to do now at scale and reach the drawdown we need, which is taking the carbon out of the atmosphere by 2040. We can do it. And this film looks at that a little bit, 2040. It should be a TV series, really. It's a bit crammed. But it basically looks at what if we implemented some of the stuff we know how to do? What would the world look like if we did that? And quite quickly, it's a lot better. Very quickly, in fact. And it's better in every sense. Better quality of life. Better businesses. Better well-being. This is a really useful thing to read. We often have lacked visions in this conversation. Visions of what's better to lead people towards. Cristiano Figueres, again, this book, The Future We Choose, which I'm taking a lot of inspiration from in this talk. You can read about this in Fast Company. What does that world look like? It's an extract from that book. And it's a really nice place. I suspect it's somewhere we would all want to live. So I really recommend reading that. And recognizing that this stuff is already happening. And it is about scaling it up. So whether it's microgrids in Tanzania, solving some of that problem I mentioned with energy earlier, or biogas cooking in Bangladesh, or new industries building up around repairing and renewing clothing in Bolivia, or rewilding in the UK, which is massively powerful and important. Rewilding is 30, I think it's like 43 times more powerful than planting monoculture trees as a drawdown thing. And it's easier, right? You just let it do its own thing. You don't have to worry about buying trees and planting. So encourage rewilding wherever you see it. And for business, this is really key. We need to recognize that sustainability is about opportunity, not sacrifice. It's opportunity to become a new kind of business, new economy kind of business, benefiting you as a business, and there are many, many things you can do in that, and therefore, in the process, doing the right thing about the crises we're talking about here. It's a challenge because sustainability has felt like something that's a bit of a stick that you have to be beaten with and you have to catch up to, and that's really difficult. The reality is this is about opportunity. This is about being different for your sake and for all of our sakes. And if we can get that narrative into people's heads, which is increasingly what is happening, then we can go in a better direction. And just some examples, Unilever's obviously here, I haven't been paid to put this in here. 8 years of top-line growth and 290% shareholder return from what they did with their sustainable living plan. And this is sort of old world metrics. But in innovation, working in innovation, that's sort of like golden territory, right? If you can do that, extraordinary. And that was doing sustainable living products. And they have now done the key thing, which is to put sustainability at the heart of their business model. Because we think of ourselves as separate from nature, we tend to have business model, right? Human bit, and then ecology, sort of sustainability agenda on the side. That's no good. It's all one and the same thing. If we infuse our business models with the sustainable agenda here, that's how we go forward, that's how we survive this. And recognizing, as Caroline Fairbairn says here, the Director General of the CBI, this is about stealing a march on competitors. You could think about it a bit like the digital revolution, right? If you didn't do it, you're a laggard, you're behind, you might fail. If you did do it, and you did it quickly, you're out in front, you have advantage. And it's not just the new snazzy businesses that are doing this, right? It's the sort of big old stodgy ones as well. This is chapter zero, an effort to basically immerse non-executive directors with the understanding of the risks and opportunities in what is happening here to help their businesses go in the right direction for them and do the right things. And a good way of looking at this, and there are so many resources that kind of outline what business can do and how they should go about doing it, but a good way of thinking about it, a good principle, is to plan to do it forever. And it is about making plans. It's not about pledges. Pledges are helpful maybe a little bit, but it needs to be hardwired into what you're doing, the heart of the business, as I say. Focusing on zero carbon, minimizing the space we use. We're using too much of it at the moment, by far. Returning the ocean to good health, it's a key part of that biodiversity system. Eliminating the concept of waste is really important. How can we think of waste as a resource in the wrong place? As many successful businesses like Rubies in the Rubble, BioBean, are starting to do and thrive from doing so. And reimagine success. We don't have time to talk about growth in this conversation, really, but what kind of growth can we work with? How can we land the plane of growth and have a grown-up economy, to borrow the words of Catherine Trebeck? This is very simple, very high level. There's so much more detail out there, and if anyone's interested, I've got lists of resources that I can share. But again, we know what to do here. One of the things that gets thrown at us, though, in that conversation, we all come up with is, but customers don't want this. Customers don't want to do this. And the response to that is, that's a problem for your business. Because if they don't want this, then you're not going to survive as a business. So we need to help those customers understand what is happening here, give them choices to do the right things in their lives, and do them in a way that is not better than the apocalypse, because that's really hard to conceive of, and it feels like we're going to have to do something sacrificial now for the sake of something we can't even imagine later. But make it about better than Tuesday. Meeting them where they are, understanding what matters to them at the moment. What's the pain point in the existing product? How can the new version of it solve that immediately? That is how we get to them doing the right things. And thinking about, as a business, what your role is here. If you're doing nothing at the other end, obviously that's no good. The far end of being generous is a big ask, but businesses are starting to do it. When you look at someone like Microsoft, they're planning to go carbon negative, i.e. to draw down all the carbon out of the atmosphere by 2050, sort of ever. So they want to do all of the carbon that they've ever released since 1975. That's an amazing thing to do. That is a generous business. And they can do so in a way that benefits them. And just quickly on these, there are some other wonderful things here. The carpet company that became carbon neutral and is now going to carbon negative. Tesco sustainability basket metrics. I mean, the big businesses are really leaning into this and really waking up to it. Again, because they recognize the opportunities, and they recognize that if they don't do it, they don't survive as a business. So one of the problems here is that we talk about how much that costs, right? Our former, what's his name? Phil Hammond was saying that this is going to cost us £1 trillion. We can't do it, right? This is how much Project Drawdown suggests we need to spend, right? $23 to $26 trillion. And it will save us 96 to do all of the things, scale up all the things we know how to do right now to get us to that good place, right? That sounds like a lot of money, and it is a lot of money. The savings are big, but you still have to spend that initial bit, which is kind of difficult, right? But let's look at this picture quickly. This is from Information is Beautiful. This is all the trillions in the world. Remembering that a trillion is 30 millennia. Apple is at the top left there, worth $1 trillion. You've got all the GDPs and bits, you know, in the world. The combined value of the Fortune 500 companies is $27 trillion. So that is, you know, close to that number. So it's a lot, right? It's a lot. But then you recognize that the wealth hidden offshore by the rich is also $26 trillion. And then you recognize that the wealth of the 1% is $127 trillion. And you start to realize that the things that we need to do here are well within our reach. And this is not about, you know, let's distribute all the wealth around the world. But it's certainly a response. When people say we can't do this, the response is, who do you mean by we? Because we absolutely can. We just need to get those people, understand those people, incentivize those people to do the right things here, unlock that cash, essentially, that wealth, to fund the right things. So just a quick summary here. We know where we're heading, and it's not a pretty picture, but we know what we can do about it. And there are many things we can do about it, whether it's thinking about ecology as community, so vital in all of this. In recognizing that sustainability can be an opportunity, is an opportunity, not a sacrifice. Designing a distributive and regenerative economy, and recognizing this as the setting for all stories, stories that are about better than Tuesday, not just better than the apocalypse. And we didn't talk about individual responsibility here, it's an interesting topic, but what we can all do individually, speak up about this all the time, particularly in your roles, every day, everyone, setting, not story. Vote for it as well with our money. Apparently, if people move their money as individuals, it would be 27 times more powerful than everything else they could do, recycling, etc. Vote with our money, vote as citizens, and act up, disobey. Whenever you see something you don't think is going in the direction of everything we talked about here, say no. See if you can say no. Build a group of people to talk about that thing and try and change it. There's a story that goes around at the moment that we are going to be the only species in history to anticipate our own extinction and still go extinct. The dinosaurs couldn't see the asteroid coming. We can see the asteroid coming because we are the asteroid. So the real story, the real opportunity here is to tell the story of being the only species in history to anticipate its own extinction and avoid it. That is certainly a story I want to be part of. I'm sure you will do as well. And that begins with recognizing that we have a choice here, a choice to be optimistic, a choice to choose system change over climate change, and recognizing that we can do that. We know how to do it. It just takes courage, and it just takes facing the change. So, and that is a fact, by the way, not just a rallying cry. It's just a statement of fact. So thank you, and good luck.
I think you're on this one.
Oh, am I?
Okay. Yeah. I'll move over a bit. Thanks a lot, Paddy. Fascinating as always. I hope everyone else has found that as interesting as I did and did when I first sat down with Paddy in that pub and shared some chips. There are some questions on here. There's quite a lot of questions. We could end up being here a few days, I think, if we go through everything. So I think what we'll do first is go out to the floor, just humanize the process a little bit. If you've got some questions, just put your hands up and then we'll just run through them individually, obviously. So why don't you say your name, if you like to, and where you're from? Not in terms of location, but business.
Yeah, so second row. It's Danny Russell. I'm a consultant. Excellent. I've been looking forward to this since I found out you were going to be on here. I think it's genuinely, to the organisers of the conference, genuinely insightful to have somebody like you here. I've got loads of questions, but obviously just one. At the end there, you said about speak up and act up. And what I found interesting was Lawrence Fink, you put the quote up, who's the CEO of BlackRock.
Larry Fink, yeah.
Yeah, who was saying about we need to change capitalism. He earned $26.5 million in 2018. Is there an amount of hypocrisy going on with people saying, let's change, and then still taking $26.5 million in salary?
Yeah, absolutely. We're all hypocrites. We're all hypocrites in this situation. It's such a good question, and it's a really important one to address. Because if we go down the path of needing to be perfect here, then we're never going to get anywhere. It's totally okay to imagine a different system from within the existing system. It's what we have to do. And so taking steps in the right direction, making plans to do so. You know, planning, for example, as an individual to eat meat one day less a week is a powerful thing to do. You don't have to go full vegan instantly, which is very difficult to do, right, understandably. So in Larry's case, yeah, he should be challenged on that. He should be challenged to say, okay, well, if you're saying this, then why are you still earning this? But it's really important that we do listen to what he's saying and don't just discount that because he's still earning money. Do you see what I mean? Yeah. Great question.
Before we come to some other questions, I just had a question of my own. It's quite selfish of me. But in light of the current global situation and an impending recession, who knows, do you see that as a disaster for sustainable business and progressive business and economics? Or do you see it as an opportunity to push things through more rapidly?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think that this kind of depends on how we respond, right? Depends on the intention and the response to it. If we see this as, if things change and are forced to change maybe a little bit and we choose to do things differently, unlike in 2008 when we kind of just did the same again after the crash, then we might go in the right direction. If we try and recoup all of the lost growth doing the same old stuff once we're out the other side, then that's very, very damaging indeed. So it's about how we respond to that. And the other thing I'd say is it's an opportunity here for us to recognize that point I made earlier about we are nature. We are a part of nature, not apart from it, as Attenborough says. Recognizing that right now by seeing what's happening with coronavirus and that encouraging us to see that is maybe a really good opportunity that comes out of this horrible thing.
Thank you. Any other questions? I'm going to go here first.
John Alexander, I run an organisation called New Citizenship Project. I'm chairing the session this afternoon. I guess I sort of want you to speak to me as if I were a young market researcher kind of coming up in the industry. The sort of we can do this feels like a we as a species. Talk to me, maybe, if you can. I know that's super hard. Like,
yeah.
What's my agency right now?
So again, I think the speak up, show up, act up is a good way of framing it, because as a market researcher, what you're doing is you're going around and understanding what is happening and informing your clients about that, or whoever it is that's reading what you're researching, to encourage them to maybe do things slightly differently. So one of the best things you can do is to really understand what we've been talking about and what that means for whoever it is you're talking to and help them on the journey of understanding. That is an incredibly powerful position to be in. And then also, as an individual, there are, of course, all of the things that you can do, making a plan to eat less meat, making a plan to fly less, et cetera, et cetera. And most of that stuff, if not all of it, gives you a better quality of life very quickly, indeed. And certainly, if you're doing that from a market researcher point of view and going into the businesses and telling the right thing to do, you're going to succeed as a market researcher because you're going to be helping them in the right direction and they'll thank you for it. So hopefully that answers that. Yeah, kind of. Okay.
I kind of had a response to that, actually, which is a really interesting question, because we had something similar come up recently where we were asked to, sorry, Denise from C-Space, we were asked to research a product that we could see would have a non-sustainable byproduct by using it. And we're stuck in this position where we're thinking, okay, we don't really like this as people because we don't really want to advocate for it, but we don't feel like we have the power to say to the client, I don't think this is a good idea, do you think we should be doing this? Like, is that our responsibility? And actually, interestingly, of course, you put it in front of consumers and a minority of them come back with concerns, with sustainability concerns, because we know most people are going, oh, but it's useful, it's convenient, I can use this in my everyday. So what we did was we looked at trends and we framed the insight, and we said, look, not people aren't responding to it now, but if you want something that's future-proofed, and you look at where perceptions are going, then I would consider that in the future more people will be saying X, and that's just something to think about when you're creating this thing, because you want it to be selling in 5 years' time, not just next week. So that was one way that we try to kind of have an influence by using data and using consumer insight, but framing it in a way that future-proofed it, as opposed to just look at what people are saying today.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, definitely.
And I had a question.
Yeah.
First off, I was really interested to see that there wasn't sustainability in the 3-point action plan of MRS, so I'd be quite interested to see if that's, and Jane, I'm sure, will have a response to that, which I'll be really interested in. Is there any, because I think one of the challenges when you speak to people is they say, look, you know, I'm recycling, I'm trying to do my bit, but look at Trump, look at China, what is the point? It's all going down the toilet. Is there any hope that you can give me that I can pass on to other people to say, yes, there are devils that are not helping and he's not signing up to the right agreements and he doesn't look as though he's buying into it, and many more like him. Is there any hope you can give me that there is change or influence happening? Even as slow as it might be, the cogs are turning, that something is happening to break down that massive, seemingly impermeable wall of resistance.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think the thing to notice with Trump is what's happening around him. And in the US, businesses and local communities are working very hard to sort of hit the Paris agreements despite what Trump is doing. So there's a lot of hope in that. I can't remember the exact quote, but you know, it only takes a small group of people to change the world. That's all that ever has changed it. So with that mindset, we can think about the impact that we can have as individuals. And the other thing to note is, you know, it takes 20% of a sector to do something different for the whole sector to change. Okay. So quite quickly, if you're getting early movers to do something different, it doesn't take long for the whole thing to then flip. And that will put pressure on Trump. You know, Trump saying we need jobs, here's 45,000 in coal, when he really understands there are 400,000 available from renewables. And that is, if that is genuinely what he cares about, then things start to go in a good way.
Do you want to come back? Come back, Jane.
Thank you. It's a good challenge. And essentially, what we're planning to do was start with this presentation today so that we've all got a chance to hear what the issues are and perhaps take some of the challenges. We've then got Jeb Forkas from Firefish, who's going to chair a round table to try and decide exactly what MRS can do on behalf of you all bringing the sector together. We then have a conference in July, but by that time we hope to be able to announce a programme where MRS, a bit like the inclusion programme, is bringing together the sector and doing things that we can do to encourage you to do things that you can do, because it's not obviously about the MRS doing things, we're just a small professional body. But so that is the plan. We thought that this would be a great kickoff. So thank you for giving me that opportunity to advertise the next programme.
I think just one other point in there, which is interesting, is that often comes back as a challenge. Why bother, right? If everyone else is not doing it, just imagine you're in a house with five people, and there's a fire in the house, and you're the only one with the willingness to spray water on it. That's still worth doing, isn't it? Right. So, I think, and as we talk about in here, it's making things better quickly. It's not about having to make enormous sacrifices to do stuff. You're going to win out by doing the right thing here, rather than sacrifice where others aren't having to.
Thanks a lot. We're going to have to wrap up, unfortunately. There's a lot of questions. Maybe Paddy's going to be hanging out.
I'll be around,
for a bit,
yeah.
So just go and get him a tea and have a chat. Thanks a lot for the question. Thanks a lot for the opportunity originally to when I spoke to Nikki to kind of pass on Paddy's details and for us to get Paddy in here. So I'm really happy about that. Keep striving. Keep making those changes, and thanks to Paddy.
Thank you.